Bangalore Homeopathic Medical College, Mangalore. It is a platform provided for homeopathic practitioners and students all over India to enhance their knowledge by listening to the stalwarts of homeopathy. This webinar series will be continued up to 4th August 2020. It's my privilege to welcome our administrator, Reverend Father Roshan Karasta, Principal Dr. Shiv Prasad K., Vice Principal Dr. ESJ Prabhu Kiran for this session today. I also welcome an international speaker for today's session, Dr. Nicola Coutinho, who is here to speak on the topic psoriasis, homeopathic approach and management. I welcome the moderator for today's session, Dr. Joshna Shiv Prasad, Professor and HOD of the Department of Pediatrics. I request the moderator to take over the session. Over to you, ma'am.
Good evening and a warm welcome to all the participants for today's webinar session. I'm Dr. Joshna Shiv Prasad, Head of the Department of Pediatrics of Padamula Homeopathic Medical College, the moderator for today's session. Before we get started with the session by Dr. Nicola Coutinho, I would like to give a brief introduction about her. She has done her early education from Goa. Her BHMS and master's degrees were obtained from Padamula Homeopathic Medical College, which is affiliated to Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences, Karnataka, India. She has graduated at the top of her class for both bachelor's and master's degree. Nicola Coutinho is a medically trained homeopath from Goa, India, who lives in Hamburg, Germany, and practices in both countries. She taught in Kamakshi Devi Homeopathic Medical College, Goa, for a brief period, and then moved to practice. In the 10 years since she began practicing, she has been a speaker at various national and international conferences and is re-qualified as a homeopath in new language and country, Germany. In her Indian practice, besides consulting, she regularly holds free health camps for slum dwellers, organizes free homeopathic seminars to raise public awareness, and keeps a monthly clinical discussion with students, as well as a monthly newsletter with health snippets for her patients. Nicola is part of School of Homeopathy, Hamburg, which is one of the last surviving homeopathic learning centers in Germany. She also offers seminars and training programs to qualified homeopaths. Earlier this year, she, along with others, founded the Competence Forum for Homeopathy, Germany. She also works with Homeopaths Without Borders in Germany. She has three research projects to her credit and is now part of an ongoing research at campus, Germany. She is happily married to Kai and is blessed with a son, Zane. Dr. Nicola is a renowned practitioner who stands out amidst many of the homeopaths, and it's my pride to have her as my student. Her topic for today is psoriasis, homeopathic management and approach. Psoriasis is a common dermatological condition affecting 2-3% of the population. It's an immune-mediated auto-inflammatory condition of the skin in which the skin cells multiply 10 times faster than the normal. Clinically, the patients present with silvery white scales, itchy dry patches, which could be quite embarrassing and can have a negative impact on the quality of life. People who have psoriasis are likely to be affected by other conditions linked to inflammation like heart disease, obesity, non-alcoholic liver disease, and metabolic syndrome. Patients present with acute exacerbations and remissions, with stress being one of the triggering factors. Homeopathy cures a large percentage of psoriasis cases. And to enlighten us on this, we have Dr. Nicola Coutinho with us. Over to you, Dr. Nicola Coutinho.
Thank you, ma'am, for your kind introduction. And thank you for also introducing the topic. I'm happy I don't have to repeat that again, and I can dive straight into what I have prepared. Let me just share my screen before I can begin. Yes. All right, so thank you very much for this privilege of having me present for the webinar. very happy to share my two cents with you. And what I have intended for this webinar is not to focus on stuff that you can read from a textbook, because we all know it through sitting through hours of college and university. That's boring, right? So I'm going to focus on stuff that is probably different, maybe inputs from my practice, research papers, and the like. So forgive me for not going into great detail about what you can find in a textbook. I'm sure you can do that yourselves. So psoriasis, as we know, as ma'am explained, is a very complex genetic disorder. It's multifactorial, it's inflammatory, it runs through families. And at the same time, there are two questions when it comes to the medicine part of it that I would like to answer in this webinar. One is what you're treating really psoriasis, or are you treating something else? So I'm going to talk about the mimickers of psoriasis, something that looks very much like psoriasis, both at the skin level as well as the joint level. And the second very interesting point, which ma'am already mentioned, is about obesity. Are obesity and psoriasis connected in any way? This for me was a very interesting aspect, and you'll see why through one of my cases that I present. More about that in a while. I also have some more questions that I'd like to tackle from the homeopathic perspective. How to deal with cases that are not responding to the remedy? You've searched, you've taken the case, done your repertorization, you've come up with a remedy, you think you have the potency, you give it, nothing. What sort of toolkit should a practitioner have? And by this, I don't mean physical tools. I mean methods. What do you do when your preferred method of working does not work? And the third very interesting question, which I think I've recently stumbled upon a possible solution, is that how come so many different methods and schools of thought all seem to work? We have so many available platforms in homeopathy, someone prescribing single dose, someone prescribing multiple doses, someone prescribing daily doses, or different, a big variety of things, and they all seem to work. There must be a reason, right? So I'd like to, if time permits, spend a little while explaining and exploring that. All right, having said that, let's dive straight into what psoriasis is. It's an immune-mediated inflammatory skin disease. It has plaques of red, scaly, and well-demarcated regions of inflamed skin, as you see in the previous picture that I just showed here. Where is it? Okay, anyway, we come through more of those. And it is a response of the immune system. It is not just a dermatological condition. It is a response of the T cells and the cytokines. Now what does that mean? Please bear with me. Don't switch off so early in the webinar. I promise I'll make this interesting. So I want to explain what this means. What is the meaning of this cytokine-mediated immune response? Now, in psoriasis, you know, it is as if the body is attacking itself. It's an immune autoimmune disease, right? The body doesn't recognize its own cells and starts attacking. And there are certain policemen in our immune system that can either favor this or stop it. And those policemen that I'd like to introduce you to are called cytokines, okay? Think of cytokines as the policemen, as I said, of your immune system. And in the case of psoriasis, they act to promote inflammation. Okay, they're basically proteins. So cyto, the word cyto means cell, and kine means movement. So they help movement between the cells, especially in the immune system. And in the case of psoriasis, they promote inflammation. So in a very simple broken down form, I'm going to explain the pathophysiology of psoriasis and how this relates to the miasms. If this is all getting too much for you, since this is not an interactive session, just focus on the red text. Forget about the black, okay? So basically, we have plaques of red, scaly, inflamed skin, which is due to an increase between 8 to 10 times, yeah? Increase in the keratinocyte production, okay? The keratinocytes are cells which are present in the upper layer of the epidermis, in our skin and our nails predominantly, and these go into overdrive, into overproduction. So what that leads to is basically more and more layers of skin, causing a thickening of the epidermis. Are you with me so far? Relatively easy to understand. No, more cells are produced, there's thickening. That is called acanthosis. There is an altered protein expression, we know, because the cytokines are involved, the whole immune system is involved. There is a loss of the granular layer of the skin, as well as retention of the keratinocyte nuclei. Normally, these nuclei are lost, but in the case of psoriasis, they are retained. Now, bear with me. There's a reason I'm explaining all of this, not just putting it up here. This is called parakeratosis. Okay. All of this in turn also is accompanied with the formation of new blood vessels called dermal angiogenesis. So what happens? There are new blood vessels. There's more space for blood to flow. Therefore, there's a greater influx of inflammatory cells, leading to more inflammation. The cytokines are doing their happy dance. And then you have a vicious circle where you have inflammation, again, leading to more keratinocyte production, and the whole cycle goes on and on and on. Okay, if you look at this, again, if this is too confusing and too much, focus only on the text in red. You have inflammation, you have plaques of red and scaly skin caused because of increase in the keratinocyte production, which is basically an inflammatory response of the immune system. Okay. Now, if we look at inflammation, we all know that belongs to the psoriatic miasm. It's an expression of psora. Is psoriasis predominantly belonging to the psoric miasm? I don't think so, for reasons that are detailed just below that. You have thickening, you have hyperproliferation, you have accumulation. Okay, all these lead to a psychotic expression. You have the formation of new blood vessels. Again, you have another dance to the inflammatory cells coming in. So back to a psoric component. Okay, so it's largely a disease of the psoric and the psychotic, predominantly psychotic miasm. And later on, as we go through the presentation, you will see that there are a lot of destructive changes which occur because of this immune response. For example, with the nails, we'll come to that later, and the joints. Okay. Once the deformity starts setting in and the cell structure is getting destroyed, then you can think of it going towards the tubercular and the syphilitic miasms. I hope this makes some amount of sense to those listening. If not, I'm happy to take questions at the end. All right. Moving further, again, to give you a visual representation of what I just explained, the normal skin looks like the picture on your left. When you have psoriasis, the epidermal layer, specifically the keratinocytes, go into overproduction. Okay, and they keep multiplying much faster than a normal person, between 8 to 10 times the rate of a normal person. Therefore, you have the flakes and the scales. The symptoms, as we all know, you have red patches of skin covered with thick silvery scales. In children, it's more common to have small scaling spots. The skin will be dry, it may itch. The itching may be severe or it may not be. This is not a diagnostic criteria for psoriasis. You can have cases where there is itching that is not really marked. Okay, you have nail changes, specifically pitting of the nails, and swollen or stiff joints in some number of cases, not in all. Coming to the comorbidities, this is an important fraction of understanding psoriasis, which I as a student never paid attention to. So I'm assuming that most of us as students don't. We just focus on the dermat part of it. But there's a good number of patients, and I have confirmed this in practice, that suffer from hypertension, that suffer from a fat metabolism disorder, who have coronary heart disease, or who even have diabetes. Okay, it is your duty as a physician to make sure that you see if your patient who you are treating for psoriasis is also suffering from these comorbidities, because they are linked. And according to these studies, I've put up the number for you. This is a statistical analysis of how many people with psoriasis suffer from these comorbidities. This is just something to keep in mind so that you know what to expect with the prognosis of your case. Because say you're treating your case of psoriasis and then they come up with heart disease, you need to know what part of it is the evolution of the disease or what part of it is caused because of drug effects, both allopathic as well as homeopathic. Okay, this helps you to differentiate and know the evolution of the disease picture. Coming to the types of psoriasis, I'm only going to do this in brief because you have textbooks for this. There are 7 main types. If you include nail psoriasis and joint psoriasis, here I'm talking only about the skin. Plaque psoriasis, which is also called psoriasis vulgaris, is the most common type. Between 70 to 80% are those that present with this type of psoriasis. That's your classic silvery, scaly appearance of the skin, red and inflamed, generalized all over the body. You have the other variety, which is not so common, called guttate psoriasis, which presents as these small circular salmon or pink colored spots on the trunk. This is very common in children, and especially after an upper respiratory tract infection with streptococcus. The third and the confusing variety is called flexural psoriasis or inverse psoriasis, because this variety of psoriasis, unlike the classical presentation, classically you get psoriasis on the extensor surfaces. Okay, so extensor surface of the elbow, the knees, the back, the scalp. In flexural or inverse, it is just the opposite. You get the lesions and the patches on the folds of the skin, okay? In the armpits, in the inside of the knee, in the inside of the elbow. Okay, the picture that you see is around the umbilicus, around the abdominal folds, below the mammary glands. Now, what is special about this type of psoriasis is that it does not present with the big, thick, silvery flakes. Okay, so it is a difficult one to diagnose. Then the fourth variety we have is pustular psoriasis. This is a sterile variety of psoriasis. So they develop a lot of pus formation all over the body. It may be predominantly palma or plantar, but it can also be generalized. The danger is when pustular psoriasis becomes generalized, you have to be careful because there can be complications. The fifth and the most dangerous type of psoriasis is called erythrodermic psoriasis, which is a generalized erythema. It covers most of the body surface area, and that is the reason why it becomes very dangerous, because they can have fever and chills, and due to the large surface area, there is secondary dehydration. Okay, and what happens is, because, as I explained, there is new vessel formation in psoriasis, right? So all the blood from the body gets pushed to the periphery, which can lead to cardiac instability. Okay, it can also lead to high output cardiac failure or hypotension. So, and this is just about 3% of all psoriasis cases. So in all likelihood, you will not have had a case like this, but you need to know just in case you come across a case, and then you have to, these patients most of the time require hospitalization. Okay, coming to nail psoriasis, these are the signs that you most commonly see. On the top left corner, you see pitting of the nails, which are either shallow or deep hollows in the nails. This is a very common sign. The second one next to it that you see is onycholysis, which is separation of the nail from the nail bed. It usually starts on the sides and then progresses towards the center. The third one that you see top right is called subungual hyperkeratosis. This is because of all the cells that I spoke about earlier, the hyperproliferation of the cells. They go and they lodge between the nail and the nail bed, causing accumulation and ultimately separation. Okay. The fourth picture that you see is a diagnostic sign of psoriasis. That is called the oil drop sign, which, as the name explains, looks like a drop of oil in the middle of the nail. It is a light pinkish salmon colored drop. It is usually translucent. And this is again because of the increase in keratinocyte cells, specifically the ones who have not lost their nuclei yet. They go and they lodge over there, and that is what gives this particular appearance. Okay, for diagnosis and signs of psoriasis, psoriasis is mainly a clinical diagnosis. You need to be able to rule out other diseases, which we will come to in a minute. The typical signs of psoriasis are your candle wax sign. If you look at the picture on the right, the scales look like candle wax. That's why candle wax sign. Auspitz sign is when these scales are rubbed off with a glass slide. You get tiny bleeding spots or petechiae. That is called Auspitz sign. Cobner phenomenon is seen in several other autoimmune diseases as well. This is when you begin developing lesions in areas of trauma. And the trauma can be anything from hitting yourself against something to a sunburn. So this is important to keep in mind. And as we spoke about in the previous slide, the oil drop sign. Now, very often, if the person presents with psoriatic arthritis, you might want to rule out rheumatoid arthritis, in which case, you know, the rheumatoid factor in this case is negative. Most of the time, ESR is normal, except in pustular or erythrodermic psoriasis. Now, another interesting point here is uric acid may be raised. Okay, psoriatic arthritis might look very much like gout. And we all know in gout, uric acid levels are raised. Here too, it may be raised, especially in pustular psoriasis. Okay, so these are signs just to keep in mind when it comes to the diagnosis of the condition. Sometimes you get patients coming to you and saying, my shoes feel tighter and I can't open jars. Most of us would just, okay, not listen to that symptom and move on. But this can be a very early sign of arthritis. Why shoes feel tight? Because the joints are swollen. And psoriasis in particular affects the small joints. Okay, we'll come specifically to which joints it affects. It can affect the big joints as well, no doubt. Okay, but it can also affect the small ones. Or they have trouble to open a tight jar. And this happens very often with older people that we know. 10 to 30% of people who suffer from psoriasis have joint involvement. Okay, and it usually develops within 5 to 12 years of diagnosis. However, there is a small percentage, 10 to 15%, who do not develop skin lesions first, but they develop joint pains. Okay, this is a very tricky one because then it's difficult to diagnose what they have. Clinical confirmation, if you need, you need to do a CBC, ESR, C-reactive protein, which is usually raised because it's an inflammatory marker, rheumatoid factor, CCP, which is anticyclic citrullinated peptide, which is almost always positive in cases of RA, uric acid levels, as well as imaging to check for deformities, and then you can differentiate between the classic deformities of RA and psoriatic arthritis. All right. This is what psoriatic arthritis looks like. Small joints are affected, mostly, can also affect the big joints. The distal joints are affected, therefore they look like sausages. This is a classic sausage digit appearance, what you see in the picture. The joints are swollen and they may also have fatigue. Now to differentiate, as I said, there are a lot of diagnoses which can mimic psoriasis. So let's differentiate between whether it is gout or psoriasis, psoriatic arthritis. Okay, I've listed the mimickers for you, the differential diagnosis. There are many, okay? But in the purview of this short webinar, I have just picked the most confusing. So we have eczema, seborrheic dermatitis, tinea, rheumatoid arthritis, and gout. Okay, let's start with the joints, as we were talking about the joints. So in gout, you know, you have the tophi visible, which are whitish depositions that you find on the toe or on the pinna of the ear. The joint pains in gout occur very suddenly, in that they can be extremely painful. Psoriasis is a more gradual buildup. And in gout, as we know, the predominant joint affected is the big toe, the first big toe. In psoriatic arthritis, most of the time, you will have skin plaques to go with it. They usually complain of back pain. Nail changes may be seen, as well as pain in the heel and the sole. Okay, this is one way to differentiate. As I said, uric acid levels can help, but there are some types of psoriasis which also have increased uric acid levels. All right, going to rheumatoid arthritis versus psoriatic arthritis. Rheumatoid arthritis is also an autoimmune disease. They have very similar evolutions of the disease. You will have family history, you will have inflammatory markers present, okay? Small joints as well as big joints can be affected, but predominantly in rheumatoid arthritis, it is symmetrical joint affection. In psoriatic arthritis, it is asymmetrical. Can be symmetrical, but largely asymmetrical. As I said, in medicine and in homeopathy, never say never, right? We can only talk about majorities. In rheumatoid arthritis, it is the proximal interphalangeal joints that are affected. Whereas in psoriatic, it is the distal, therefore the sausage digit appearance. Also in psoriatic arthritis, the tendons are more affected. In rheumatoid arthritis, you have very classic deformities that we know about. I'm not going to go into detail. And if you do the tests, then rheumatoid factor and CCP are positive. Not the case in psoriatic arthritis. And in most of the cases, skin plaques and nail changes accompany. Okay, this is, one is eczema, one is psoriasis. Very quickly, make up your mind which is which. It's easy. The one with the scales is psoriasis. The other one is eczema, but this is one of the most commonly confused skin diagnoses. Again, this is more clear here. Eczema on the flexural surfaces of the knees and psoriasis on the extensor surface. Another differential diagnosis which can be very confusing is seborrheic dermatitis. In seborrheic dermatitis, if you look at the scales, this is on the right side of your screen, the scales look yellowish, they are more greasy, and when you compare them to psoriasis, they are thinner. Okay. In psoriasis, as you see on the left side of your screen, the lesions are red, they are irregular, and the scales are usually silvery and much thicker. And here again, scalp psoriasis and seborrheic dermatitis. Another new term that dermatologists use recently is called sebo-psoriasis, which is a combination of seborrheic dermatitis and psoriasis, where it's very, very difficult to distinguish between the two. The other diagnosis which comes very close is all your tinea infections. They're very difficult sometimes to distinguish. One differentiating point is that in ringworm or tinea, your lesions are well demarcated. They are circular. They may or may not have a central area of clearing. Whereas in psoriasis, the lesions are not so regular and not well demarcated. And most of the time they have scaling, massive scaling compared to tinea. In conventional treatment, this is how it is divided. Mild psoriasis, that is less than 10% of the surface area of the body is affected, is treated with creams, basically steroidal creams and light therapy. So they expose them to psoralen, which is a chemical compound, as well as UV rays, type A or type B. Moderate to severe psoriasis, where more than 10% of the body is affected, is treated with bathing salts and solutions, as well as drugs like methotrexate. When it comes to psoriatic arthritis, then they have inflammatory inhibitors, painkillers, and immunosuppressants. What these drugs do are that they suppress the immune system, just so you know. And there's a reason I'm telling you this, because it matters in our treatment. Okay, as I said, I was going to come back to the connection between obesity and psoriasis. You have, this was a German study that was undertaken studying people with psoriasis, and how many of them were obese. And there was found to be a definite correlation between the two. So what happens is psoriasis causes systemic inflammation. Okay, all the TNF, IL that you see are tumor necrosis factor, interleukins, which promote inflammation. This in turn goes and stimulates the visceral fat tissue to release pro-inflammatory cytokines. And the cycle continues. So the fatter you are, the more cells you have that can be triggered. Okay. So this study shows that there is a definite correlation between a higher BMI and psoriasis. Also that physical activity and weight loss can improve symptoms. This is something that I never really in my student days paid attention to, but I'm seeing it in practice where patients are reporting feeling better after engaging in physical exercise. And this is something that's free and available to everybody. Okay. So one point to remember for your practice while treating psoriasis patients. Okay, so now we go to cases of mine. I have 8 cases in total, out of which I will do 4 in detail or relative detail. Again, these are my cases which I have worked through. And what I find when I attend seminars and webinars is that I only see the success cases from practitioners. And I did not want to do the same with mine. So I'm presenting everything to you, the good, the bad, the ugly, so that you know that this is what happens in daily practice. It's not only the fantastic single remedy, single dose cases that fill our practices. On the contrary, it's the frustrating ones that take our night's sleep and make us better practitioners in the end. Okay. So I'm going to present all of these. And as I go through them, I will speak about the methods that I have used, the challenges that I have failed, that I have faced. And at the same time, I would also like to say, it is very important to stick to the basics, no matter what you try everything that you want to, but stick to the basics. Don't lose sight of your basic laws, the basic cardinal principles of homeopathy, the guidance given in the Organon of Medicine. These are invaluable. Okay. Keep your mind open, but at the same time, don't forget the basics. Okay. So let's start with our first lady. my first, she was actually my first psoriasis case that I treated. She's a 61-year-old female. I call her the candle maker to keep her identity secret and also a reason why. She was suffering from psoriasis for 18 years when she came to me. She had been to all sorts of doctors, done all sorts of treatments, visited several homeopaths, and received a lot of arsenic, alb, and silicea over and over and over again. She had warts as well accompanying her symptoms, and she came with lesions on the scalp mostly, and on the hands. Hands were the bad ones, and the fingers. She explained to me when I went digging into her evolution of the case, because as you know, autoimmune diseases very often are triggered by stress. So I started digging, and then I got out her LifeSpace investigation, which told me that she has been harboring a lot of anger and hatred, the typical Indian daughter-in-law story, against her mother-in-law and sister-in-law. She said, "I hate them. I have been carrying this anger for so many years. My husband never supported me. I was always unjustly treated, but I kept quiet. I did everything." And at some point, after she had had her three children, she found relief and delight in making candles and in her garden. That was her escape. Okay, she's a very creative person by nature. And this is a picture of her, by the way, with her face covered. She's someone who loves dancing, very creative. She would always be the life of the party. Sorry. She was someone who's always running around. They would call her social butterfly. So she started escaping into this candle making and into her garden. And she started ignoring her kids. Okay, she became indifferent to them. She did not want to have anything to do with them. This was her escape. She had a craving for sweets. She was chilly. She told me, "Now I'm lonely, but I'm happy. And I don't need their love. I care a damn." This was her attitude. Okay, this was her evolution of the disease. She had suffered from these complaints for very long. I repertorized her case, went through it. And this was her in 2016. When she came to me, this was one of the bad lesions. Here she's not scratched as much, otherwise it would usually be bleeding, itching. Hers was a typical case of psoriasis vulgaris or plaque psoriasis. Yeah. This is 2017. Her remedy was Sepia 200. Okay. Now in this case, my learning was one, it was a difficult case because this woman is a relative. Okay. When the patient is a relative, you have the whole family behind them. So that becomes a very interesting factor in your prescription. Second, I realized I was able to identify trigger points in her case, and I took that into the evolution of the disease. This case will come up again because at the end, I have made a table of all my cases and I've evaluated them. And in this lady's case, this is now 2020, she is still with me. She is not cured of her psoriasis, but majority of her lesions have gone. She also suffers from psoriatic arthritis. So whenever she's stressed, these lesions will come up. She has sometimes lesions which suddenly come up overnight in the genital area. Okay, and she has received very infrequent doses of Sepia. She's had several accidents, lumbar disc prolapse, trauma, where I have prescribed other remedies like Arnica and Hypericum. But this is a case that I find very dynamic. She keeps on coming up with an exacerbation. As Dr. Josna was mentioning in the beginning, this is not a case where you can, you know, give one remedy and go and say bye-bye. There are cases like that, but those are more the exceptions than the rule. The rules are these, where you want to pull your hair out sometimes when things are not working your way. Okay, so this was one of the first cases I treated of psoriasis, and she responded very well to Sepia. This now is an ongoing case of mine in my clinic in Hamburg. This is a young man. You can see from the picture, he has generalized lesions all over the body. This is a case that is keeping me up at night at the moment. So this looks like I have it under control, correct? Like it looks not so bad. It's okay. I thought he was fine. I was very happy with my remedy selection. I thought, this is going to be a one remedy, one dose case. I'm very happy. He's going to respond very well. I was very wrong. So he came to me for the first time in April. This was his state about 3 weeks ago, the four pictures that you see. I will explain his case in brief to you. This is a person, he's a 30-year-old student who is originally Indian. He suffered from the complaints for the last 6 years. Okay, let's go through what is on the screen as well as the evolution. At the age of 16, his father lost his job and he was worried about finances, but not so much. He was more worried that his father was not working because his father had so much potential. Why is he not working? And there's constantly been drama between the two of them, father and son. Okay. Then he grew up in Dubai. He moved from there to Nagpur. Completely different change of scenario. He did a diploma there. Life for him was very, very hard. 2014, his father lost his job again. Between 2014 and 15 is when this boy started developing his first lesions. Okay. Then in 2017-18, he took up three jobs in Dubai. He was back in Dubai. He took up three jobs. He used to work about 16 hours a day and he was going into a state of burnout. Finally, in 2018, with the help of an uncle of his, he decided to move to Germany for further studies. And since then, he's been here. When I went into what he is like a person, he said to him, the most important thing that matters is the human connection. He loves to be a leader. He loves the limelight. He was extra conscious about his skin. Very few people who know him know that he suffers from this diagnosis. He was able to keep it under control until it started appearing on his face and head. He's so conscious about this that he explained to me, he will not go to the barber if there is another person inside. Okay, and this might be understandable in India because people talk, but now where he is, where he lives, this is Hamburg. Okay, and people don't care. You can do what you want. You can be running half naked on the street. People will just say, okay, he's having a bad day or good day, whatever. Nobody cares. But still, this boy feels very, very conscious because of his lesions to go into the barbershop. He will wait outside till everybody is gone and then he'll go in. Okay. If he has to go swimming, he will not go swimming without a long sleeve t-shirt. He has fear of darkness and of ferocious dogs. I found him, my observation was that he had very feminine characteristics in the way he spoke, the way he held himself, the way he was groomed. Okay. He craved pork, chocolate, ice cream, aversion to milk and bitter, hot patient, aggravated by humidity, heat. Better by exercise. This was the case that I was telling you about, where this patient is much better by doing exercise. He says, whenever I go to the gym, I don't know how it matters, my lesions get better. And he is not somebody who is overweight. He's fine. He's in the moderate range. He has recurrent tonsillitis with every weather change. Okay, so initially my prescription for him was tuberculinum 200. I was very happy with my choice of remedy. And he was better even. He was on tuberculinum for 2 months, like two doses, one in February, one in April. He was better. And then somewhere end of April, he came to me and said, no, this is not working. He had more lesions. He was suffering through a sort of depressive spell, very strained relation with his father had come up again. I redid the case. I retook it. I reanalyzed it. I gave him pulsatilla this time. Pulsatilla twice I repeated. It did not do much of a great deal with him. I thought, okay, I'm wrong again. So again, I reworked his case. And this time I sat and I did it with a colleague. It's like, okay, maybe I'm missing something in the case. And I came up with phosphorus. Okay, so I gave him phosphorus, single dose. He responded pretty well, but not that well. So then I repeated phosphorus. I gave him a single dose every day for 5 days. And this is what he sent me on the 15th of July last week, saying, I feel great improvement in my lesions more than ever before. And when I looked at the pictures, I was like, why is he saying he's feeling improvement? For me, they look same. Like, oh, what is this nonsense? No, they look the same to me. If you look, the left side picture looks a little less, little more inflamed. Right side looks a little less, but it looks the same. It's not like this lovely case I showed you in the first one. Like, lesion gone. So little background before I go further in the pictures. I mentioned that this was a case where I had non-compliance. Now the case was complicated, if you see the last line, with non-compliance, meaning he was using a heavy duty steroidal cream, a cream of emollients with urea, which is the standard prescription for psoriasis. And every time I asked him to please stop it, he said, okay, but he never stopped it. Okay. And this I got out when he sent me a mail saying, I'm so depressed, doctor. I don't think homeopathy is going to work for me. I don't know what to do. Celery juice and homeopathy are my last hope. I don't know how to go forward. So then I was able to make my entry again and tell him, please stop using everything that you're using. All steroid creams, all emollients, everything with urea, all cosmetics, because he had one cream for his face, one cream for something else, one cream for going out in the sun. It was getting too much. So I stopped him from all of it. I told him not to even use soap while taking a bath. He said, what, no soap? I said, yeah, no soap. We live in Hamburg. It's not so hot here. It's okay. You're not going to stink like a pig. If you need to use soap, then use it in the axillary areas and the genital areas. And if at all, use something mild like Sebamed, which he followed. And then 1 week later after phosphorus, this is what he sent me. So even though I didn't feel like there's much improvement, he's very happy with the lesions. If you look at the lesions, there is some amount of clearing. Okay, on the left side is before, right side is after. There is some amount of clearing, but it's not great. You see the back, he has very extensive lesions. And this is his leg. Okay. Now he tells me recently, I had a history of nosebleeds. I used to get nosebleeds very often. Have you had them recently? No, I haven't had them recently. Okay, so I thought, okay, maybe that is one more confirmatory point for phosphorus. Now today, interestingly, just before this webinar, he sent me a mail with a picture saying, I'm having some flaking on my forehead. And I thought, oh Lord, again, this is starting again, my remedy is wrong. And then he told me he was out in the sun for 2 days. So probably that. And later he tells me I lost my grandmother on Thursday. Okay, so I will not be surprised at all if he has an aggravation and requires a repetition of the remedy, because as we know, stress, grief, strong emotions play a big part in autoimmune conditions. Okay. So I asked him how he's dealing with it. I haven't spoken to him yet. I'll probably do it after the call. He said he watched the funeral over Zoom. Obviously travel is not possible at this time. And his first 2 days were very hard dealing with it because he was close to her. But this is something that complicates a chronic case, which is at such a deep level, a genetic and an autoimmune level. The case has gotten complicated now with these new developments. Okay. One thing I learned from this case is how drastically I can change stuff with just making sure the patient stops all external applications. Sometimes you tell them, they say yes, but they don't do. Okay. For 6 months, this fellow didn't do what I've been asking him to do, but now he has, and we've both seen the difference. Okay. Another application that I advise in the case of very dry skin is a mixture of rose water and glycerin. 1:1 proportions, because that helps to make the scales softer, because the more dry the skin, the more itching. And then again, you have this whole vicious cycle of itching, scratching, bleeding, and the whole cycle repeats. Some cases, they're happy to just use coconut oil, which I advise. And interestingly, I found coconut oil is much better with Asian skin types. A lot of the Europeans to whom I have given coconut oil, big disaster. So with them, I stick to either almond or olive oil. Okay. So you always have to try. There is no one method fits all. Preferably keep them off all cosmetics, all chemicals. Okay, this is my next case. Another case where I learned a lot. This is a fish seller. He came to me with bleeding and itching. This was a case referred to me by one of my professors. Bleeding and itching with after contact with chemicals. And he was already on Visalon. He was taking steroids. He was taking antihistamines. He was somebody who had hypertension. So he was on hypertensives. And he had aggravation in November, December time. Cold season, cold air, touch was all aggravation. He was better by sleep. This was interesting. He told me, I don't need to take my hypertension tablet the day I get good sleep. So what do you mean by good sleep? He said, look, madam, I'm a fish. I have to sell fish. So to sell fish, I have to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning. I go to sleep only at 11, 12 in the night. So the days I don't get sleep, I take my tablet. If there's one day where I get 2 hours more sleep, I feel much better. I don't need to take my tablet. If I check also, my BP is in normal range. He's very thirsty. Little inquiry into his background revealed that he's a very religious man. And he always believed that there was a proper way to do things. Okay. Now, this was a man who came in a hurry to my clinic and he told me, I have 5 minutes. So I thought, okay, I'm the doctor and you have 5 minutes. Okay. So anyway, I took his case. You can see the lesions over here. He has cracked skin on the palm and on the lower limbs as well. He was always getting these bleeding spots. He was diagnosed by an allopath as palmoplantar psoriasis. Okay, treatment challenges in this case. He gave me very few symptoms to work with. Okay, he was not willing to tell me more. He had lack of time. He was already on steroids, which are immunosuppressants, as we know. So they appear to help, but they don't really do much when the person is on homeopathy, because they suppress, right? And in my experience, I found that this complicates the case. Anyway, so what I did in this case, and this is something that I'm very interested to share with all of you, is I did something called polarity analysis. Okay, this is a method of repertorization where you use the modalities of the case, strong modalities, a minimum of 5 modalities, and then you go from there. I will explain this in detail, so bear with me. This might not be understandable at first glance. Just bear with me. I will explain it and break it down for you. Okay, so this is again in 1 month's time. If you see on the left side are his cracks on the hands. On the right side, when he came in 1 month's time, all the cracks had disappeared. The lesions were much better. He had them on the extensor surfaces of the elbows. On the knees, extensor surface. If you see, the cracks have all closed up in the second picture. The skin is still thick and dry. It has gone off now. Recently, when I had a follow-up with him, all the discoloration and the scars have gone. Here we see under the sole. This was in 1 month's time. Okay, so to explain a little bit about what polarity analysis is it is based on the symptom grading from BTPB. Bonninghausen's method. The main things that he focuses on here are polarity difference and contraindication. Now, what is the meaning of this? A lot of symptoms that we have are called polar symptoms because they have the exact opposite. Okay, like better by cold, worse by cold. Or as I mentioned, that thirst or lack of thirst. Okay, better by movement, aggravation by movement. These are two polarities. And that is one of the reasons why our homeopathy is so confusing. You look at a remedy, does it have this symptom? Yes. Does it have the exact opposite symptom? Yes. So how to prescribe? It's confusing, right? So many remedies, as I said, show these two polarities, but to different degrees. For example, pulsatilla is thirstless in a higher degree than pulsatilla being thirsty. Okay. And Bonninghausen used this particular difference to find contraindications in the remedies. He said, okay, if I have a patient who is extremely thirsty and one of my choices is pulsatilla, I will rule it out because pulsatilla is thirstless and my patient is thirsty. Okay, this is very simple, a very basic example I'm giving you. And this method of polarity analysis that I used has been put into a system by a Swiss doctor called Dr. Heiner Frey, who is a pediatric hematologist, if I'm not mistaken, and a homeopath. And he was finding it very difficult to, you know, make progress with prescribing homeopathy and getting results. So he put all of this into one software, which, by the way, is available to everybody to test for free. I have given you the links at the end of the presentation. Please go and check it out. He's a very nice man, this guy. I've met him for a couple of his seminars. And the interesting thing is that he offers this software free to people in Asia. Even in Europe, his prices are nothing. It's very, very low. And for all of the Asian subcontinent, it's free, this particular software, what I showed you. I'm going to show you again. Now, is this still classical homeopathy? Because I said, what did I say in the beginning? Stick to the basics. If you go to aphorism 133, Hahnemann talks about sticking to modalities. Okay. And this is precisely what is done over here. It just organizes all the modalities into a systematic manner. You take modalities which are strange, rare, peculiar to the patient, to the disease. Okay. And then do you base your prescription only on the modalities? Of course not. Okay. In aphorism 211, Hahnemann writes clearly that the patient's emotional state often tips the scale. So you have to look back into your materia medica, take the remedies, read them up, and then make your final choice of the remedy. Okay. This particular method of polarity analysis has been proved by a double-blind study to increase prescription accuracy. The study was done on ADHD cases. Dr. Heiner Frey is someone who focuses a lot on children and therefore ADHD and autism. And you can find the study on his website. I have put all the links for you in the last slide, so don't worry. All the information has been shared in the last slide. You can look at it. So coming back to the repertorial sheet, okay, let's go through all the symptoms. If you see the top list of symptoms, air, desire for open air, okay, I've put all the modalities of my patient first because these are all polar symptoms. Aggravation, cold in general. Aggravation, weather, air, cold. Aggravation, touch, thirst, and better by sleep. These are all symptoms which have a polar opposite. So what you do is you put this into the software, your symptoms. Automatically, the software takes into consideration the exact opposite symptoms. Okay, you see the exact opposite modalities. So aversion to open air, better by cold, better by air and weather, cold, better by touch, absent thirst, and aggravation, sleep. This is your polar opposite. Now, if you look at the repertorial sheet, you see there are some remedies in white and some remedies in gray. Okay, let's talk about the gray remedies first. These are remedies which are contraindicated. For example, let's take bryonia. Okay, here's bryonia. You look at bryonia. And when you look down, you see here 3CI. That means contraindication. Why? Because our patient has a desire for open air, correct? When you see here, bryonia has that as one mark. But bryonia has also the exact opposite symptom, aversion to open air, as a 3-mark symptom. That means by virtue of having the opposite true, bryonia is contraindicated. Similarly, you can see it for other remedies as well. Everything marked in gray is what is contraindicated. Everything that is left white is what is still not contraindicated. So in this case, my choices were arsenic, ruta, phosphoric acid. Okay. So I again looked back to my materia medica, and in his case, I prescribed arsenic alb, Q potency. I gave him 0/3. Every day he was taking a repetition. Now he only comes once in a while when he has stress, because this is a man who is father to a Down syndrome child who's 30 years old living with him. He's aggressive. He has mental imbalance. Obviously, they come from a poor background, socioeconomic status. So he has stresses, and when he needs, he comes back for a repeat dose. Okay. So this is what polarity analysis looks like. This is, I know, difficult to digest probably at the first glance, but as I said, I'm happy to answer questions about it later. But I urge you all, please go to the website and look at it for yourself, because it is very much in tune with classical homeopathy. And it is a relatively easier method to go about when you have just a few symptoms and good modalities to work with. Remember, you have to have a minimum of 5 modalities, strong modalities that you can work with. Okay. And as I mentioned earlier, this is one of the toolkits you can have in your practitioner box. Okay. One of your methods of approaching a case. Because if you remember, Stuart Close wrote about this. There may not be one straight road to the simillimum. Sometimes you have to take a zigzag, and then ultimately you will reach there. You know? Because what I find is when we attend seminars and webinars, we only see the good part of practitioners' cases. We see the wow results and we think, oh my God, I'm such a horrible practitioner. I don't have that. No, but that's not the truth. All of us have cases that are this fat because we've been taking them, failing, but they're still coming back, thankfully. And that is what is important, and that's what I want to share today. So I'm also sharing my failed cases as well as my cases that are confusing. Okay. And also different methods, because sometimes it might not help to just approach a case in one way. You might want to try something new. So this is something new that you can incorporate straight away. Polarity analysis is easy. It's something you can use when you have enough of modalities. Of course, it may not apply to every case. All right. Let's move to case number 4. Okay, so this is a relatively small case compared to the other cases. This is a legal officer, 33-year-old male, who came to me with lesions since 5 years. And his first lesions began on the head after head injury. Unfortunately, I don't have pictures of that head because that cleared off very, very fast. And we didn't take proper pictures. They were too blurred to present. So in his history, he married against the wishes of his parents and was cut off from the family. He's easily offended, still grieving his parents' reaction, fear of disease, and he's extremely restless. He explained his restlessness so much that he cannot go to a movie theater and watch a movie from beginning to end. He's unable to sit. Okay. So working with this case, what struck me was also the lesions appearing for the first time after head injury. okay, after a traumatic event. This is Cobner's phenomenon, but usually Cobner's phenomenon takes place once the disease has already started. But in this case, it was the very first trigger event. And I was not clear with the rest of the picture. So we started him on Arnica 200. This man responded beautifully to Arnica 200. These pictures are approximately a month apart. Okay, these are the change in his lesions. I was on top of the world once I heard about this response from this patient. And I enjoyed my success for some time until I heard through another source that he met one of my colleagues from the Goa College who told him, what is this rubbish? This doctor's given you Arnica for psoriasis. You must be mad. You come to me. So I never saw the patient again. And I heard that he's gone to this particular practitioner who prescribes tinctures and tinctures and tinctures. But anyway, I'm happy I did my part. And I learned something from this case, which was giving importance to the causative factor when it is strong and prominent enough. And it showed a wonderful result. But also sharing with you my frustration of the case, that I could not enjoy the fruits completely. Patient left because he was told by another person that I'm an immature doctor. Anyway, everyday life and practice. Okay, so here is a compilation of all the 8 cases that I wanted to bring to you. We have discussed the candle maker. We have discussed the fish seller. We have discussed the legal officer and the student. Okay. So the other 4 cases, I have just compiled them over here because time does not permit to go into great detail about all of them. But if you see, I have mentioned the trigger events in all of them. And it's very nice to look at a whole compilation of all of them. In the case of the candle maker, there was anger and hatred as the trigger factors, which ultimately led into indifference. Okay, and she was someone who, one of the only persons who has the joint affections. In her case, I find the outcome is good, but she keeps having relapses and flare-ups when there is a stress factor. In the case of the fish seller, his trigger was chemical contact. Maybe there were more emotional triggers, but I don't know because he's a man of few words and he did not want to talk to me about it. And I did not want to push him because I knew if I had pushed him, I would have lost him as a patient. In his case, we prescribed arsenicarb 0/3. His outcome was very good. This was a case of a tailor, 34-year-old female, who had a lot of stress with her marriage. She developed mouth ulcers. She's had psoriasis since 14 years. And she was prescribed Nux Vomica. She was not at all better. This was a completely failed case. Then we have the sailor, 35-year-old male. His trigger factor was job stress. This was someone who was working on the ship and was not given the promotion that he wanted. He was prescribed by my team. This was not a prescription of mine. Pulse 30. We never heard from him again, so we don't know. Then we have the housewife whose trigger was grief and shock. She had multiple comorbidities, cervical spondylosis, gastritis, varicose veins. She was given Natremuse 0/3. She had some amount of improvement. Then we have the lawyer, 35-year-old male. Again, trigger factor was job stress, graphitis 30. We don't know the outcome because he did not follow up long enough. And finally is the student that we discussed, whose trigger was stress with the father, overwork, as well as financial stuff. And he was given a series of remedies now, tuberculinum, pulsatilla, and now phosphorus. His is an ongoing treatment that I am hoping will turn out well, but I just wanted to put all of this out there for you so that you see that not all cases from practitioners who present are fantastic, one single remedy, one single dose successes. They are not. These are struggles that all of us go through, and it's nice to have various ways to overcome them. Okay, now this is something I recently came across, may or may not resonate with everybody. This is something that another Indian homeopath has put forward called Shilpa Boraskar, and she's come up with this 4 stages template. Okay, she says in stage 1 is the disease diagnosis, stage 2 is disease particular PQRS symptoms, stage 3 is general or constitutional or person-specific PQRS. And stage 4 is the vital sensation, source, vital energy, whatever. Why am I telling you this? Because of my question I asked at the beginning about how is that that different methods of homeopathy all seem to have some amount of success. And I believe the answer is here. She explains how people can come to you at different ages of their disease evolution, and you as a practitioner can practice at different stages between these four stages. Okay, what do they mean exactly? Little more detail. Stage one, like if you take example of malaria fever, what is your disease diagnosis? Malaria. What are the symptoms? Classic fever and chills, symptoms of malaria. That can be just a snapshot prescription. Okay, we give China because it is malaria. No more questions asked. Okay, this might be something like what the Banerjee protocol is. For example, in psoriasis, Banerjee protocol, if I'm not mistaken, I won't do it. It's not something for me. But it is done, it exists. And they have success also. Stage two is disease particular symptoms. So if you're taking a China fever, then you know the fever has well-marked paroxysms. They have chills from everything that they drink. Every sip of water will cause them to have chills. They have cold hands and feet. They might have a craving for juicy things. Stage three. Okay, so at stage two, you could also think of what I presented now, polarity analysis. Okay, or prescribing on disease-specific symptoms. Stage three comes to the constitutional aspect, where you have like the China constitution. Okay, they look sanguineous, stout, healthy before, and then broken down, exhausted, anemic later on. And then you look at other remedies in the China group that are similar. This is basically constitutional prescription, what most of us do. And finally, stage four is schools of thought like Shankaran, where you go to vital sensation, source and energy, you go down to the sensation of China, no longer sticking to the materia medica and repertory. Okay. Possibly what we could add to stage three is also prescribers like George Vitalgas, Prafal Vijaykar. This is a different school of thought, right? So my understanding is that also you as a practitioner, maybe you are versatile in all four stages, or maybe you have one, which is your area of expertise. And then accordingly, you will attract patients who are comfortable with your way of prescribing. Like people who go to the persons who prescribe Banerjee protocol, they know that they're not going to have a long in-depth case taking. Disease diagnosis, prescription. On the other end of the spectrum, you have people who go to the sensation and the school of song, inner song method, where it is a much more detailed case taking. 2 hours, 3 hours, longer even. And that is fine with them. Okay, so as a practitioner, maybe you develop one particular stage that you are good at. But obviously, it is possibly very good if you are able to be flexible between all and change your methodology as per what your patient requires. Because, for example, if my fish seller came to me and I tried to do a sensation method case taking with him for 3 hours, he would have run away in the first 15 minutes. Would not have happened. Right. At the same time, now practicing in Hamburg, there is a different expectation from my patients who want to sit and talk to me longer because conventional medicine gives them 2 minutes. Okay. They come between an hour or so, first case taking. And sometimes I have finished the case in 20 minutes. So I know the remedy. But just because that is the kind of expectation and my time is paid for, I go on for the whole 60 minutes. Okay. So it's also about expectation from both sides, patient as well as practitioner. All right, these were my 2 cents on the topic. And my learning so far with psoriasis, just to summarize everything in a nutshell, motivation is very important to keep the patient on track. It's not easy for them looking so disfiguring. It's a taboo in society. So you as a practitioner and a physician need to be able to motivate them and keep them on your homeopathic treatment. Check for signs of comorbidities if they're suffering from cardiac conditions, diabetes, hypertension. Encourage them by all means to work out more, to engage in more physical exercise, to lose weight if they are overweight. And of course, discourage the use of medical creams and cosmetics. If the indicated remedy fails, which happens very often, hit refresh. Look at your case from a different perspective. Retake it if required. Maybe try a different approach. Consult with your colleagues. You definitely have colleagues who have a different perspective or a different viewpoint, and they will be able to give you more information on what you require. Okay, so keep an open mind and look at all these angles. It's not easy treating psoriasis because, for one, it is a chronic condition. It keeps coming up with flares. So you cannot say, okay, I've given the remedy, gone, this is fine, finished, they'll never contact me again. No, they will keep coming back. And it doesn't mean that you as a practitioner have failed. Conventional medicine does not provide any cure for psoriasis. They just prescribe steroidal creams or immunosuppressant tablets, and that's the end of it. Okay. But as a homeopathic practitioner, you can accompany your patient on a very nice healing journey and give them a good outcome in their cases of psoriasis. Okay. I like this particular saying that insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, but expecting different results, which is why I urge you to keep an open mind. And at the same time, don't forget your basics, stick to the cardinal principles and consult your colleagues, because that I find in our homeopathic circles is something invaluable. It's something that I've learned to do now practicing in a different country. It's very common here for a homeopath to sit with colleagues once a month, and each one brings their difficult cases which they are not able to progress with. These are all the references that I have used. I've given you all the links to check up everything that I've said. Please feel free to ask questions, or if time does not permit, you can email me later and ask questions. I'm happy to answer. That is all from my side. Thank you very much, and I hope it was an enjoyable session.
Thank you, Dr. Nicola, for your enthusiastic and informative session. I think we didn't have much of questions. Only in the first case, Dr. Mithila had a question, like, what you gave Arnica and Hypericum.
She had acute injuries. She had acute injuries that had all the symptoms of arnica at one point of time. This is a case I've had with me since 2016. So she keeps in touch with me very regularly. And she had some acute injuries which had the classic picture of arnica at one time and hypericum at one time. So that's what they were prescribed for.
Okay. Right. So I don't see much of questions. Except for that that Hammer's theory, whether you are that Hammer's theory.
This is something, this is something which is a very controversial topic in Germany as well as with my colleagues. Because to put it in a very short way is that Hammer was a very controversial figure when he was practicing. And he also ascribed to a lot of the Nazi tenets. And that is something completely taboo here. I know that a lot of people follow, the German New Medicine and predictive homeopathy with the mind of pathology, mind of posology. Some aspects, yes. But if you go on the street here and in circles, talk to people about Hammer's theory, it's a big taboo. So yes, there are some aspects that I see, like, for example, to give a very short point, just in general, not every case, people presenting with right-sided complaints, you can sometimes tend to correlate that to problems with a spouse or problems with their particular job. Left-sided complaints sometimes can correlate to a sibling or a child or a parent. Okay. At the same time, you can also go into psoriasis and talk about conflicts, that they have two different conflicts on two different levels. But this is all theory, so I prefer to stay clear of a lot of controversies.
Okay, right. Then there's one more question coming up. Why did you prescribe Asalp 0/3?
That's a good question. So in a lot of my skin cases, I have found that when I prescribe in the C potencies, they tend to have a really bad aggravation, and I don't like repeating the C potencies too often. So the LM potencies, for whatever reason, I don't know the reason, they seem to act deeper, but they do not produce such a bad aggravation, and they can be given up over a long period of time. Why 0/3? Because 1 and 2 were not available.
Okay. Because there's one more question. Any specification in potency selection?
Again, it is based on the case and their susceptibility. If the symptom similarity is very good, their susceptibility is good, I will go higher. Okay. But as I said, in skin cases in general, and I have a lot of skin cases at the moment, I find that when they're complicated cases and I'm expecting an aggravation and I feel, okay, patient is going to drop out if they have a bad aggravation, I stick to LM potencies. Okay. If I know it's someone who says, okay, I don't mind, you give me an aggravation, I'm happy, then I give them 200 and I'm happy, we're both happy. Because the LM potencies are also much more expensive here to prescribe.
Okay. And there was one more question. Can we tell the patients to withdraw steroids once they start our treatment? Is it safe? Like?
Again, this is a case-to-case decision. In the case of skin, what happens is you have to decide whether it's a mild, moderate or severe psoriasis you're treating. If you're treating a severe psoriasis and the person is on steroids for years and years, I would not immediately withdraw it. Definitely not, because then they will have a massive withdrawal to whatever withdrawal symptoms they have. You will not be able to handle it. Rather, it is better to wean them. And also there comes the big question of ethics. As far as I'm concerned, I do wean my patient off their remedies myself. I send them back to the doctor who has prescribed it after prescribing homeopathy, and that doctor most of the time will either wean them off or put them completely off the steroids. So ethically, I have a problem with reducing drugs that are not prescribed by me.
So step by step you do it, I think.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, slowly you withdraw. Okay. Then there's one more question. When there is blackish lesions on the skin, how can you differentiate it from eczema? There's a question.
Exactly. Blackish. Okay. The thing is, eczema and psoriasis are very closely related. So eczema tends to present with more itching than psoriasis. But as we discussed, the lesions in psoriasis are very typical. They are not well demarcated. They are scaling. They are deep red if it is a psoriasis vulgaris case. Okay, in eczema, again, you have symptoms which mimic psoriasis and they tend to be more on the flexural aspect of the body. Whereas psoriasis is extensor surfaces, eczema tends to be more flexural. But if you have a case of inverse psoriasis, then you're screwed. Then it's more difficult to differentiate.
Okay, then there's a question whether Dr. Rickwick products are safe to use, whether you have used whether any...
Liquid?
No, Rickwick, there's a company, no?
Yeah, it's a producer of remedies. Yeah, Hughes, whatever the local pharmacies, we have local producers. And Rickwick is big in India, but it's not big here.
Okay, so you're not very sure.
I have not come across any Rickwick here, actually. In India, yes, plenty. I have used. But single remedies, not the combinations.
Okay, what about acute exacerbation, your approach in that, someone has asked?
Again, you treat the case as it comes to you. If it is an acute flare-up of the disease because of what you have prescribed, then you let them ride it out. But if you need to prescribe, then you can look at different ways. Either you repeat the same drug in a higher potency to take care of the aggravation if it's indicated, but this is tricky. Or you give a complementary remedy, or you take the totality again and you prescribe whatever remedy is indicated.
Okay. Then there's a question by a person. Any difference between Asian and non-Asian based people on the potency, whether there's any difference?
Not that I have found out. Maybe some years later this might come up, but I'm just practicing now in Hamburg since 2 years that I have my own clinic here. So 2 years is not enough time to compare.
Okay, Dr. Varsha has asked what type of lubricating agent. I think you told about rose water and glycerin.
Yeah, I asked them to make a mixture of rose water and glycerin 1:1 parts and use it usually after bath because that softens the scales and it's not medicated.
Then someone has asked about that Arnica case, legal officer, like how many years back he had that head injury?
5 years. Five years back. And interestingly, if you go to Borick, where Arnica is mentioned, he mentions there all types of traumatic injuries, mental or physical. And in this case, he was not just mentally traumatized, not just physically traumatized. He was also mentally traumatized by what went on with his family, the break, the cutoff from his family. The restlessness of Arnica was there.
Okay. Then there's a question by Dr. Mithila. How is homeopathy in Germany? What method they follow? Any specific method?
It's like in India, it's very different. Everybody does their own thing. But the big difference about the practice of homeopathy here is that you don't necessarily have to be a medical doctor to practice homeopathy. That is one big difference. The second difference is the education system that we have in India is far superior to what you have here. And I know this firsthand because I'm teaching here. You cannot compare. It's not even close. So they actually have a great deal of respect for homeopaths who are trained in India.
Okay. Then they have asked whether you can provide some information regarding that software which you're using.
Yeah, that is in the last slide that I shared. The name of the doctor is Dr. Heiner Frey. Maybe if I type it into the chat, everybody will get. I will type the website for you. It is available in English as well. The first one might be in German, but I've typed the website to everybody. There you have the link to polarity analysis, what it means. And I guess once you get the whole video and the slides, you will be able to see all the references that I have mentioned.
Then there's a question by Dr. BPC. Can we use petroleum jelly?
You can do everything, but I prefer not to use.
Okay. So software name, I think many have asked. They can go to the last.
Polarity line. Analysis, correct. Okay. Wait, should I share that again?
And what about...
Yes, ma'am?
Somebody has asked, Dr. Shreya has asked whether we can use homeopathic ointments. We get some patents.
Okay. No. I mean, I wouldn't do it because then you're complicating your case yourself. Please don't. External applications, if you read the organ and answers there, please don't.
Okay. Then there's a person who wants to know how to go to Germany and practice there.
Contact me. First learn German, then contact me. Okay. Here, this is the one for the software, polarity analysis.
Okay. And one more question from Bhupender. Are homeopathic medicines easily available to everyone in Germany?
Yes, they are easily available, but below a certain potency, they are not available. Then you need a prescription from a doctor. Like all the opiates, so opium is not available below D4 and D6. Below these potencies, you cannot buy all the drugs like opium, cannabis. These are not available, but the higher potencies are over-the-counter medicines. You can just go and ask for them.
There's Dr. Shiva Prasad. He's asking, what is your experience with Kaliars and Asayud?
Okay, good question. I have used them in skin cases, but not particularly in psoriasis. Kaliars and Asayud.
Okay.
Yeah, okay, interesting. No, I have used them, but as constitutional medicines and not as specifics for skin. And they've never come up in a psoriasis case so far.
All right. Dr. Ninga Reddy had put a question. It was regarding the oil. You said whether they can use some oil. He was asking.
I was used to prescribing coconut oil. Then by experience, I learned that not everybody responds well to coconut oil. Therefore, I switch sometimes between almond and olive oil. Because the whole thing in psoriasis is that you need to keep the scales soft and hydrated. Okay.
So you can recommend some oil also. I think Dr. Ninga Reddy is satisfied with the answer. Oh, right. What is the quality of medicine there? Someone is asking.
Quality is very good. But what we use over here in the practice with my colleagues, we have 5 homeopaths who practice in this area. Our full cabinet of medicines is from Roy and Company, most of them. And then when I come home, I bring remedies from India. So quality is good in both countries.
Okay. So I hope ma'am has answered, Dr. Nicola has answered most of the questions. Okay, there's one more question by Dr. Payal. Which oil should we use in fungal infection? Acute.
Oil. I wouldn't use an oil in fungal infection that is medicated. Again, stick to unmedicated stuff when you're treating homeopathically. Avoid external applications as far as possible. Okay.
I think ma'am has answered that. So, right, is there any cure for acne? Sneha has a question related to acne.
Again, to say whether a case is curable or not curable, you need to take the case and then decide. No?
All right. Okay.
But yes, so, I would like to say yes.
So, if it's done with the questions, I'll just summarize. So I think we had a very informative and enthusiastic session by Dr. Nicola, where she spoke about the theoretical part, then the comorbidities, the types, And she also told us about the diagnosis, signs and symptoms. And she beautifully explained her experience with four important cases. And there were some cases in which she failed, which she highlighted those cases also, so that the students should know that we may have failures also when we are practicing, but we should not lose hope. So she very beautifully she presented all those cases. And with this, I thank you once again, Dr. Nicola. You're getting a lot of positive remarks in the chat box. And thank you once again from my side. Over to the MC of today. Thank you, Dr.
On behalf of the organizing team, ProVision 2020, I express my gratitude and respect for our distinguished speaker, Dr. Nicola Coutinho, for sparing her invaluable time for us and enlightening us with her commendable talk on psoriasis by illustrating the success as well as failure cases. Thank you, Doctor. I would also like to thank the moderator for the session, Dr. Joshna Shivprasad. I would like to thank the administrator, Reverend Father Roshan Krasta, Principal Dr. Shivprasad K, and Vice Principal Dr. ESJ Prabhu Kiran for their valuable support for the ProVision 2020. I express my gratitude to the webinar organizing team headed by Dr. Dheeraj Fernandez, who have been working hard to make this webinar series a successful one. Finally, I thank all the delegates who have dedicated their time in being a part of this session actively. We have the best of sessions in the upcoming days. Please stay tuned with us. Dear delegates, tomorrow we have a session by Dr. Shailendra Singh presenting on the topic liver diagnosis, staging and treatment. Thank you. Have a good night.
Thank you.